praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Might do a little bit of spitting, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
That's what he said back there, so some of them sit way in the back, but we have been talking about, I've been talking about broken relationships, and today we are in part six of broken relationships. And before we go any further in this series, or before I say anything, I want to know if this is helping you in it.
Amen.
Has it helped you, the broken relationship? Because if it hasn't, then we can just go to something else. But I want to know that if it's helping you, and if it's making a difference in your life, not only for you just to hear the word, but also for you to put it to work in your life. Has it helped anybody lately?
Amen.
I just know about it.
Yes.
Chasing something else. Has it helped anybody?
Yes.
You can shout, you can holler, you can tell me yes, you can tell me no, you can be honest. I want to know, has this series been helping anybody today?
Yes.
Shall we continue?
Yes.
Can I tell you something?
Yes.
I want you to look at your neighbor right now, and I want you to tell them, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Tell them again.
Neighbor.
Tell them again.
Neighbor.
I need you to pay real close attention to me. Tell them, pay attention to me. Tell them, pay attention to me. To you guys. Tell them what he's going to teach right now. It's going to hurt. Tell them again, it's going to hurt. So if you need some band-aids, let me know. Because I know I'm going to need some. What I have today is probably something that is not being maybe taught in churches, or maybe sometimes pastors are afraid to teach it because of what it has, because of the message itself. But what I want to say is we preach what the Bible says. And whatever the Bible says, that's what we preach. So a lot of the big time churches, what they do a lot of the times is that they don't preach certain messages because they don't want people to leave the church. And the reason they don't want people to leave is because they want their money. Amen. And I'm just being totally honest, I come from a big church. I come from a 1,000-member church. That's where we came from. And I'm just telling you, there's certain things that they... I went to go preach at a church that was, I don't care, remember how many members was that church in Houston. I think it was like maybe 800-member church. It was about 800, 900-member church. They called me up there to go preach. And 30 minutes before me going up there to take the stage, to take the microphone to preach, they pulled me over to this room, to the pastor's office, sat me down, he said, I want to know everything you're going to preach, and I want you to tell me every scripture you're going to use. He said, because we don't do this here. Well, they were paying for our hotel. They were paying for everything that we, you know, were there. And I told them, yes, but I went ahead and preached what God gave me that day. And I heard at times the pastor say from the bottom, not at this church. We don't do that at this church. But there's churches that do that. They take the ministers to the side and they tell them, you can't preach this, you can't preach that, you can't preach about this, you can't preach about this. You know, and a lot of the things that were said, I was like, wow. You know, we have taken some stuff away from the Bible, said we're not going to tell the people about this because it'll hurt them. And not knowing that the stuff that I'm going to preach today is not, it might hurt a little bit, but it's for our own good. And it's going to help us. Amen? Because in order for you to be healed, a lot of times when you're sick, they make you take stuff that you don't like. Right?
Amen.
When you're sick, they make you take medicine that tastes nasty. But you take it because it does good, because it'll heal you. Amen? They tell you to put peroxide or something on your cut and it's going to hurt you, but they tell you that it's going to cure and it's going to clean out whatever wound or whatever it is. You know, that's what they used to tell us, you know, back when I was small. They used to put alcohol in, like, it'll be good. And you're there burning up and you're like, ugh, you saw the bottle of alcohol, you would run from it. Amen, anybody? And you know, but you knew that was going to help. Or at least you thought, because that's what your mom or your dad told you. So you believed what they said. Amen? So the word of God had been written by your father. Actually, he spoke it into men, and they wrote it for you and I. So everything that is in here, some of it is going to hurt, but it's for our own good. Say amen, somebody. So we have been talking about broken relationships, and my prayer is that every time we come in here and we teach about this, is that it'll help you as a couple. It'll help you not only, this is not only for marriages, but it's also for people, for friendships, people that are, you know, your friends or whoever it may be. My prayer is that you learn in what category we're going to put the people in. You need to learn where this person goes. You need to know where that person goes in. That's what we have been talking about for a while. Amen? So I want you to understand, and I want you to grab everything that I'm going to preach today. Amen? And I got some notes here, but really, I don't know which way I'm going. I mean, I do know. I just don't think that I'm going to go through all these things right here. And I think the Holy Spirit is going to do something else.
Amen.
But we're just going to flow. Look at your neighbor and say, let's just flow. That's all we're going to do, just flow. Amen. Not flower, flow. Look at your neighbor and say, let's flow. But you got to say, let's flow. Yeah, there you go, flow. This scripture that I'm about to give you today is a scripture that Jesus is one of the first teachings that Jesus did. And I want you to imagine in your mind, as I begin to read this scripture, as Jesus is speaking these words to the multitude, Jesus was speaking this word to them. I want you to imagine in your mind how the people were feeling or what they were getting, because this was the very first time, because Jesus is about to come in and just freak them out with these words. Okay? So I want you to imagine what they're about to feel once they hear the words of Jesus. Amen? So go to Luke chapter 6, verse 27. That's where we're going to start. Luke 6, 27. When you're there, say amen.
Amen.
You got it up there?
Okay.
If you don't have it, you can just look up here. We'll have it up here. This is the Lord saying. This is a good word. My God. I can already see people moving around there. But I say to you, but listen. He says, but I say to you who listen, because although there were many people there, not everybody was listening. You know how many people come to church and how many really actually listen? I've heard people when they leave the church and they tell them, hey, what did Pastor preach? I don't know. I have no idea what he preached. Why? Because they were not paying attention to the word. Their body was here, but their mind was at HEB or at Walmart or whatever it is that they were going to cook, or they left the beans on, did I leave the iron on? What was going on? So a lot of the people come to church, but just their body and their mind is probably still laying down in bed. So Jesus comes into the scene and he says, but I say to you who listen, love your enemies, and not only love your enemies, but he says, do good to those who... Do you know how hard it is for you to do good to somebody who hates you?
Amen.
Mm. Wow.
Come on, Pastor. Come on.
Some of you probably learned this in high school, or not in high school. Some of you probably learned this in Sunday school. But here you are 40 years later, you still have not... You still having issues or trouble trying to love your enemy. Or trying to love a hater. But I say to you, is anybody listening here today?
Yes.
Let me say that again. Is anybody listening here today?
Yes.
If you're listening, raise your hands, please.
Yes.
I know where you're going, Pastor. Love your enemies. Do good to those that hate you.
That's right.
Mm. Verse 28 gets better. Bless those who curse you. For those of you who think that the only good thing you have in your hand is that little finger, bless those who curse you, and then what? Woo-hoo. This is gonna be good. Bless those who curse you. We do totally the opposite. They curse me, I'm cursing them back. Come on, somebody. It is quiet here. They throw me the finger, my window's going down, and my right hand is going back out, and I'm going to give them the Hawaiian good luck charm. Or it would be maybe like the sister would always say, and that sister Gonzalez over there sitting in the back, she always said, this was before BCC. We did a lot of stuff before BCC, right? So it says, bless those who curse you, and not only bless them, but he says, do you know how hard it is to come to prayer?
Yeah.
After all the hell you've been through at work? You know how hard it is to pray for your boss after they passed you from a position that you were supposed to? And you mean I'm supposed to come in here and pray for them?
Yeah.
You mean I'm supposed to pray for that person that just cut me off?
Yes,
sir.
It's
getting quiet in here.
Bring that word, Pastor. Bring it. Mm.
Not just the ones, not just bless them, but you know how hard it is to pray for somebody who's mistreated you all their life? People that have just done so much harm to you, Bible says pray for them. Well, if we were like back in the old days, I know that a lot of you, your prayer would be so much different. Be like David. Oh God, just kill them and kill them all. I don't want to see none of my enemies. That was David's prayer back then. And we don't want to pray good things on the people that mistreat us or those who curse us or those who talk about us, right? We want to pray for them. We don't want to pray good things. We don't want to say God bless them and open the heavens and just pour out a bunch of blessings upon their life. We say God open the heavens and drop a bunch of pianos on their head or something. Come on, somebody. Pray for people that just took advantage of you. Pray for people that just came in and just did you wrong. Pray for them. You know, they don't preach this stuff. And I know that we say we gotta do a lot of other stuff, but this is the stuff that Jesus came. Can you see the people in the audience, in the crowd, just looking at one another? This guy just went bananas. This guy just went crazy. I'm supposed to go to my neighbor, the one that egged my house, the one that came in and keyed my car, the one that talked about my kid, the one that pushed my kid. I'm supposed to go over there and bless them and speak blessings over their life and pray for them? That's the last thing I want to do. I want to get them and I want to strangle them. My God. You want me to continue?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Is it all right?
Yes, sir.
You must like that house stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I love them, girl. First thing, man. If anyone hits you on the cheek,
lie.
He says, offer the other one. If anyone hits you on the cheek, just turn around and let him hit the other. We can't do that, right? That's crazy, right? Jesus is telling this to the people. And the people were just like you right now. As soon as I said that, I heard a lot of people go like, but Jesus is telling them that if somebody hits you on the cheek, they used to tell us in Spanish, si alguien te pega en una mejilla, tú ponle la otra, pero pónsela morada. Those of you who don't understand Spanish, I'm sorry, but I can't. If anybody hits you, what are you going to do? So Joe, I think you're better off on your sleep, brother. I really do. Brother, you leave the door so wide open for me just to walk in there. You know me. If it's open, I'm walking in. So what are you going to do when he hits you? Pray that the next hit don't hurt. Oh my goodness. And if anybody takes away your coat, it doesn't say if anybody else borrows it. It says if anybody comes in and just takes it away, don't hold it back. Don't hold back your shirt either. In other words, don't go and take it back. Just see? You see why churches don't preach this? Because I could probably guarantee you that 50% of the people will not come back. Why? Because they don't want to hear this stuff. Tell me something that's going to, you know, come in and massage my back. Tell me something that I'm going, don't tell me none of that. I don't want to hear none of that stuff. We can't pass it away. It's here. Amen? That's why a lot of people, and listen, if you're one of the ones that you probably say, Pastor, I ain't coming back. Listen, it doesn't matter where you go. You know, can I just burst your bubble right now? The Bible says that what you already know, meaning you already heard it. So I don't care where you go. You can go to the church down in Mexico and Russia, and it's still the same word, just a different language. So he's telling us that if somebody comes in and hits you, somebody comes in and curses you, somebody comes in and slaps you, somebody comes in and does something, that you are not to react the same way that they are. Amen? That is the whole thing about when you give your life to the Lord, you're born again, meaning that you don't do the things that you used to do before. Because before, if somebody hits you, you were going to hit them back. Now if somebody hits you, you have to bite your tongue and you just have to stay quiet and not say it, just say, just walk away. Amen? That's hard. I know some of you right now probably say, God's still working with me, Pastor. God's still working on me. I saw about 20 hands. Still working on me. I don't know about that putting the cheek stuff, Pastor. That's not for me yet. Still in first grade. Come on, somebody. This is good stuff. It's biblical. It's in the Bible.
Amen.
So we cannot pick and choose. I mean, we're gonna preach something, we're gonna preach the whole thing. Say amen, somebody. So we are supposed to bless these people that are coming against us hard. Amen? We are supposed to bless them. We are supposed to pray for them. God, have you ever prayed for somebody?
Yeah.
The Bible says that when you do good to somebody who comes in and does something bad to you, the Bible says that it is like coals of fire falling on their head.
That's right.
That's what it says. Now, if you're just doing it, man, I wish those coals were for real, man. Just like falling on people. Like, security? I'm just kidding. He was quick. Brother Gilbert said, I'm real. I'm just kidding. See, if you don't laugh, you're always going to be bitter. Amen?
Amen.
I'm sorry, but I don't like bitter people. Amen. I look at them, I get bitter myself. Why are you hurting? Why are you mad? We gotta be happy.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says that David taught himself happy. In other words, there was nobody else happy around him. He just began to get happy all by himself.
Yes.
And he began to, nobody was there to encourage him, and he encouraged his own self. He said, you know what? I don't need none of these to encourage. I encourage myself.
Okay.
Sometimes you gotta do that.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Are you ready for some more?
Yes,
sir.
Let's go to verse 30. Give to everyone who asks for you, and from one who takes away your things, don't ask for them back. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, my Bible says, what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Verse 31. Just as you want others to do for you. However, it's the golden rule. They teach this in elementary. They call it the golden rule. That's what they call it. When I was in school, I remember this. They would always tell us, "What's the golden rule?" And everybody would scream. Do unto others as you want them to do unto you. So, if you want somebody, if you curse somebody, guess what? It's coming back to you. If you hit somebody, if you talk about somebody, if you do bad things to people, bad things are going to come back to you. Because that is the law of sowing and reaping. What you sow is exactly what you're going to get. So if you want people to be good to you, the reason people are not good to you, you know what I'm going to tell you, it's because you're not good to them. Why is everybody always hating on me? Because you're always hating on everybody else.
I'm good.
Why nobody respect me? Because you don't respect nobody else. Why is everybody acting like a fool? Because you're acting like a fool. Come on, somebody. You know I'm preaching. You're wondering why things are happening. You need to examine your life and figure out if you're not the one that's doing all of this to yourself and you're only reaping what you're sowing. Well, I don't want to reap like that. Well, then change. Amen. My goodness. This is good stuff. Do unto others as you want others to do unto you. This is good. And we do this when we're all when we're, you know, okay. But when it gets rough, when it gets heated, when we tell our wife, no te calientes plancha. No te esponjes, you know, don't get hot iron. You know, sounds better in Spanish. But we don't do these things when all hell is breaking loose in our house. We do totally the opposite, right? But the Bible Jesus was telling them to do this at all times.
That's right.
Don't do it just when it all is going well. No, do it every day. Uh-huh. Look at your neighbor and tell him, you got to do it every day. You got to do it every day. Now here's where Jesus is going to begin to measure their level of love, where they are in love. Amen? Some of you think that you're okay. Some of you think that you're real good. Some of you think that you're real tight with Jesus. Some of you think that you got a halo over your horns. I mean, I'm telling you, you thought I was going to say your head, right? You can hand some stuff on those things. Verse 32. This is a good word. Verse 32. If you love those who love you, what credit is that for you? If you love people that love you, it says that's no benefit to you. He said, even sinners love those who love them. He said, if you don't love the one that hates you, if you don't love the one that wants, you know, treats you bad, if you don't love the person, he said, it doesn't, he said, you know what he's saying? He said, if you don't love the people that hate you or your enemies, he says, you're acting just like the devil. You're just like them, like a sinner. Because sinners love themselves. They love the people. So the Lord says, listen, don't just love the ones that love you. Go above and beyond and love the ones that don't love you. Love the ones that hate you. Love the ones that talk about you. This is good. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. Verse 33. If you do what is good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. In other words, if you're not doing what he's telling us to do, then he's actually calling us sinners. Like we're acting just like they are. Amen? So we have to be very careful. Verse 34. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to be repaid in full. Some of you, what you have to do is put a policy in place in your life, and you have to learn something, is that you don't, if you lend money to your friends, more than likely, if those friends are not real friends, that friendship is going to end. So what do, Pastor? Instead of doing that, just give them the money. Just bless them with money. Don't tell them, I'm going to let you borrow it. Because if you tell them I'm going to let you borrow it and they don't pay back, what happens? Friendship is going to be ruined. Right? If people try to dodge you because they lend you money, you lend them money, and now they don't want you, they don't want to pay you, and now they're trying to avoid you, you lose that friendship. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
So you have, you know what? I'm not gonna lend you money. You know what? I just want to bless you. Out of the kindness of my heart, I just want to bless you. I don't need it in return. Just take it with you. Why? Because I value the relationship much more than the money. And I don't want to ruin our relationship. So I would just rather give you the money instead of lending you and expecting something in return. Amen?
Amen.
Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
You know why? Because I would rather have you as my friend as my slave. I would rather you be my friend than you be my slave. I would rather you be my slave than you be in bondage to me. Because the Bible says that those who borrow money become slaves to those who lend them the money. You go out and get a loan somewhere, you become a slave to them. And if you don't pay, they're going to come and get whatever it is that you wrote on that contract. Come on, somebody. You know I'm telling you the truth. So, you know, I'd rather become your friend than you become my slave. But I'm just going to go ahead and lend you. Let me give you the money. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
Are you guys getting anything?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Jesus. Verse 35. But love your enemies. Do what is good. And lend. Expecting nothing in How many of you in here have enemies? Everybody has enemies. If they would come to you and ask you for money, what would you say? You better leave my yard right now. Something's going to go down here. Don't even come close to mine. But the Bible says to love our enemies, do what is good, and lend them expecting nothing in return. Listen, then your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for He is gracious to the ungrateful and evil. Says, be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Jesus says, if you do good to them, I will repay you.
Amen.
I'm the one that's going to repay you. Amen?
Amen?
And so, one of the things that we have to understand is that these things right here, this what we read here, to a lot of you, it may not make sense. To a lot of you, these things are foolish to you, right? A lot of you new ones, if you read this to you, it might be foolish. Like, I'm going to love my enemy? No, Pastor, I'm sorry, but that is not in my agenda. I'm not going to do that. But the Lord is telling us to do it. Can you imagine the people hearing Jesus for the very first time? What did He say? Jesus said, listen, if you love them, don't go and ask them for anything. I'm going to pay you back. The reason that we have been so frustrated is because we're expecting return from them or a reward from them. And God never said that they were going to reward you. God said, I'm going to reward you if you just do this. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So now, are we ready?
Amen.
And you give me about 15, 20 minutes. No?
Yeah.
What are you doing here, buddy? That's to be Roberto. You know me, right? Yeah. Good thing you know me. It'd be bad if you didn't know me. So, we have to understand something. Those of you who are new, I want you to understand something. In our English vocabulary, we have different words. Well, we use one word for a lot of things, but I want you to understand something, that the Bible was not written in English. The Bible was not written in English. Amen? So, the Bible was translated to English. Amen? The Old Testament was written in Hebrew. The New Testament was written in Greek. Amen? And they made it to where we could understand. And a lot of the words in the Hebrew and in the Greek mean more than what probably they probably wrote on here in the Bible. And I'm going to give you some definitions here in a minute. And we have to understand that you know, the people that wrote the Bible in English, they did the best that they could to write it. Amen? And you know, we don't talk about them. There might be, you know, a few little minor mistakes on the translation. It's hard enough. When I translate for somebody from English to Spanish, it's hard to do that. Now imagine trying to translate it from the Greek to the English, or from the Hebrew to the English. It's a lot harder. Amen? So we use one word. Let's say the word love. The word love, we use it in so many ways. We love our cousins. We love pizza. We love our cars. We love our wives. Some of you love money. You know, you love so many things. You know, you love your dog, your cat. You know, you love your kids. There's just so many things that we use the word love for. Amen? But for the people, the Hebrews and the Greeks, to them, they defined each that word in different ways. Amen? So what you use love for, you know, hey, I love that person. Oh, you know what? I love this person. You know what? I love my church. You know what? I love my pastors. Or I love this. Or I love that. We use that word like anything. Amen? Sometimes. But in the Greek, and I'm going to give you four Greek words that describe the word love. And the Greek, they learned how to put boundaries in the relationship. Amen? And that's something that we, as Christians, we need to learn how to put these boundaries in our life. Amen? So when every time you open up your Bible and you see the word love on there, you have to ask yourself, what is he talking about? What kind of love is he talking about? Amen? So, the first one is phileo. The word phileo, it means brotherly love. It means, you know what, it's like a friendship kind of love. It means like, you got my back, I got your back. Okay? You did a favor for me, I'm going to do a favor for you. And the word phileo is getting something in return. Amen? The word phileo. The next word is stakeo. And it goes beyond friends. Stakeo is family. Amen? It's family. It's blood is thicker than water. It's a mother's love to a child, a child's love to a mother. That word there goes beyond just being friends. Amen? The third one is, and I'm going a little bit quick on this because Robert has to go home. The third one on this is your eros. Eros, E-R-O-S, eros is where we get the word, the English word, erotic. It is more sexual. The word eros is more sexual. It's more contact. It's I give you, you give me. Amen? It has to do more with feelings. And the last one is the unconditional one, which is called agape. Agape love is unconditional love. So Jesus comes in and he says, I want you to agape your enemies. He says, I want you to love your enemies unconditionally. He comes in and he tells everybody, listen, I want you to love them unconditionally. Not of what they can give you, but I want you to love them. Even if they hurt you, I want you to love them. Even if they talk about you, I want you to love them. Even if they curse you, I want you to love them. Jesus said, we have to agape the people, meaning we have to love them unconditionally. Say amen, somebody. Agape separates itself from the other three. Why? Because now you got to love whether they love you back or not. You got to love whether they curse you or not. You got to love whether they hit you or not. It is quiet in this place right now. Agape love is the only love that is not based on performance or a level of exchange. Agape is not, I'm going to love you and I'm waiting something in return. Agape is, I'm going to love you whether you give me back or not. It is hard. I know it is. I want you to lift up your hands and say, Lord, help me. I'm going to tell them, Lord, help me to love my enemies. You're right. Lord, help me. Friendship love has a level of exchange. Listen, if I do this for you, then I've already put you in debt. In other words, you owe me one. Have you ever done that? Have you ever gotten mad at somebody because they didn't do something for you that you did for them? That's not agape love, because you're waiting something for them in return. Say amen. I've been faithful to you. I helped you fix your car. I helped you with the flat. Now you don't want to help me? So, agape love is separated from all of this. Phileo is friendship. Sikeo is family. Hallelujah. Euros or eros, it is more of a sexual connection or sexual love. But the Lord says, I want you to go beyond that and don't expect nothing back from nobody. That's why the Bible says that if they ask you for something, just give it to them. Amen. You cold? Well, let me give you my jacket here. Take it. That's something that we have not have learned to do. Amen. And when once we learn how to agape the people, then we will be able to have these long-term relationships. Amen. Amen. We will be able to pass, because agape is, I don't see how you are. Agape is more of a, you know what, I don't care where you've been, I'm still going to love you. Agape is, I don't care how much mistakes you made, I'm still going to love you. Agape is, I don't care what kind of mess you're in, I'm still, listen, if you're good, if you're bad, I'm still going to love you. If you're messy, if you're all right, if you dress up all raggedy or whatever, I'm still going to love you, because I love you on your condition or your performance. I love you because he told me to love you, and I'm supposed to love you. Come on, somebody. So agape says, I'm not going to love you based on what you're giving me. If I go to your house and I knock and I ask you for sugar and you come in and talk back to me and say again, you're coming again, this is the fourth time you're coming and knock this way for sugar. Can't you just go? He says, love them.
That's right, Pastor. Amen.
Come on, somebody. Our name's going to get hard. You love them. Even if you see their weakness, you love them in their weakness. You love them in their strength. You love them when they're up and you love them when they're down. My God, hallelujah. You love them regardless of the situation or the season that they are going. You love them when they have attitudes and you love them when they don't have attitudes. Listen, you don't dislike and throw your kids out because they have a bad attitude. You still love them.
That's right.
And if you don't, why are you cleaning up behind them? Why are you still putting food on the table? Hard. Woo. Thank you, Lord. Anybody feel like running?
Yep.
Thinking about it, sir. Woo, my God. Jesus, help us, Lord. The Bible says that the kingdom is like a treasure found in the field. The Bible says that for the joy thereof, the man sold everything he had and he bought the field. Amen. He bought the field. My God. What is the field? The field is the dirt. What is the treasure? Treasure is the valuable thing in there. And isn't it amazing that the things that are more valuable have a lot of dirt on them? You were so valuable to God that you were in your mess. God said, listen, let me tell you what Jesus said. Let me tell you what God just did for you. God came in, and the Bible says that even in your transgressions,
Hallelujah.
Oh my God. He said, even in your sin,
right.
He said, even in all that mess and that junk that you were in, he said, I love you way before you even loved me.
Right.
He said, even when you were all down, even when you cursed me, when you hated me, when you talked about my son, when you didn't want to go to church, when you were broke, when you were busted and disgusted, he said, even when you were going through all of this in your life, he said, I still love you.
Thank you, my God.
He didn't say, you know what? I'm going to wait till we're buddies to see if I'm going to love you. He didn't say, I'm going to wait till you get born again to love you. He said, I'm going to love you despite what condition you're in. I'm going to love you if you love me or not. He said, if you don't love me, I'm still going to love you. I'm still going to be there for you. He said, I will not leave you nor forsake you. He said, I will love you. It does not matter where you're at, how you're doing. Hallelujah. If you're financially wealthy or not, he said, I'm going to love you. And that's what God did for us.
Amen.
And he said, all I want you to do is the same thing that I did for you.
That's right.
Well, you were yet sinner. The Bible says Christ died for you.
That's right.
Yeah. I told you that this agape love, this unconditional love, he had it for it. He said, you know what? I love you even if you offend me. Some of us stop loving people because we get offended.
That's right.
And he said, even if you offend me, I still will love you.
Right.
Even if you talk. Listen, how many of you in here, you cursed God before you came to church? How many, come on somebody. How many of y'all used God's name in vain before you came to church? Right? A lot of us do. I know a lot of us did. How many of y'all cursed the people that were preaching the word? How many of y'all talked about people that preached the word? How many of y'all still talking about people? But God said, listen, even in all your mess and everything that you were doing and how you were talking about people and how you were hating on my people, God said, I still love you. And not only did I love you, but listen, he said, I have so much love for you that when you were supposed to die, I didn't let you die.
Jesus.
Yeah. He said, when you were supposed to go down 6 feet, he said, I lifted you up, even in your mess, even in your sin, even when you were all high, when you were popping those pills, when you were getting drunk, when you were getting all drugged up, when you were putting that needle in, when you were doing your thing, he said, I loved you. He said, when they were about to pull that trigger, he said, I loved you. He said, now I'm telling you to love people and it hurts you to love them. He wants us to do that. He wants us to love just the same way that he loves us. And he doesn't want us to base our love on feelings. You know how many people go to the altar on feelings? That's sad. And you know, can I tell you what feelings really, can I tell you what feelings are? Feeling is just a chemical reaction. That's all it is. Feeling is a chemical reaction to whatever your eyes see. Whatever your eyes see, your mind will begin to trigger that chemical into your heart and you begin to feel these feelings. Amen? You go to the altar based on feelings, and you go in there, and you get married, you go to bed, you wake up the next morning, you say, whoa, what did I just do? She didn't look like that yesterday. That's the same. Better take a picture before you go get married. Because I guarantee you, the money might not look like that. And a lot of people get into relationship based on, whoo, he gave me goosebumps. AC does the same thing. Won't you go out with the AC? Not the AC guy, but the AC. Right? Come on, somebody. I'm telling you the truth. My goodness. So, we go based off of feelings. What you feel. Ooh, my goodness. We're going to go get married. Because, every time I'm with him, he says, he just makes me feel good. Look at my skin. and we don't stay there too long enough to love, to be able to love on the people, and we're based on, and what happens is that what your eyes see will trigger a chemical reaction in your body, especially us men. We're like that. Amen. We can be sitting down in the couch and in our houses and you know, sitting down, watching TV or whatever, and just making noises. They're all tired or whatever it is. I don't want to move. Don't even, you know, we don't wash the, whatever we have to wash, the dishes or the clothes or whatever. And the wife comes in and all of a sudden she goes into the shower and she begins to shower and she's putting on that, you know, that Dove soap, and all of a sudden you're like, you begin to smell that soap, you know what I mean? Come on, somebody. Can we get real? Can I get real with you today? And you know, you're all there, all tired, and you don't want to move no more because you probably work all day or whatever. And all of a sudden, she comes out of the shower, amen, with her nightgown or whatever, and she just passes by you, and all of a sudden you're like, hey, wait a minute. And you're like, I'm going to bed. You're like, you ain't going to bed. Hold on, there's a chemical reaction happening inside of me. So, and we base this off of feelings, and we don't go by feelings. Right. We go by love. We go by what we know. We go by faith. We walk by faith, amen? And God says, listen, love them that hate you and do good to those who curse you. Right. And it's hard for us to do that. It's hard for me to love that, especially if it's your partner. It's hard, right? I can't live with them. I can't stand them. You're still there. Right? Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Let me just sweep it up there. Let me just come on. You know, we do so much marriage counseling. And, you know, and sometimes we just have to laugh. You know, and it's not laugh like to make fun, but it's just sometimes it's just funny. You know, I really believe. I was like, ooh, he's getting up into our business. Well. This is in general, because it goes with everybody. Come on, somebody. All right? Is that okay? We were there once. But I'm not that. No, we were not that bad, right? But, you know when you're upset and when you're all mad, and you say things that you don't really mean. Amen. And you say them based on that chemical reaction.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm leaving, and that's it. I ain't coming back over here. You said that 15 years ago. You said that 20 years ago. You said that 30 years ago, and you're still here.
Thank you, Jesus.
So it's based off chemical reaction. Because once all of that adrenaline goes away,
oh, my God.
Y'all know I'm hitting some people. I'm stepping on people's toes right about now. Come on, somebody. Because once all of that is gone, once all of that anger and hatred, you're just like, you're like the little puppy that you're about to hit, and he knows. My dog knows when I'm upset. He knows. That dog knows when I'm mad. I just raise my voice. His name is Chico. I say, Chico, and all he does is like, and he's a little teacup chihuahua, and he's got eyes about this big, literally, I'm like, for real. And I call, when I raise my voice, you see his eyes, he's like, and sometimes we're like that ourselves, like everything, all the adrenaline's gone, all the hatred is gone, and stuff, and all of a sudden, they know. They know something we don't know, right? You know you love me. You know you didn't mean that. You did it, right? Right? Come on, somebody. You know I'm telling you the truth. And then you make up. And then all of a sudden, again, the adrenaline. I told you I was gonna leave you. And you just, all you're doing is, you gotta get ulcers, or what do you call it? Oh, that was before BCC? That was before BCC, man? That little brother there's about to be a fight over it. If you don't want to, another marriage counselor. No, I had just erased them from the, going backwards. But a lot of the stuff that we do is based off that chemical reaction. Amen. And that's how feelings is. The praise and worship could be so strong in this place, and all of a sudden it's like, ooh, I feel goosebumps. How do you know it's not easy? Because the Lord and the Holy Spirit will come and touch you whether there's praise and worship or there's a preservation.
Amen.
Amen. You don't need it, but we have gotten accustomed to the praise and worship. Right? We've gotten used to, if there's no music, I'm not praying. If there's no music, my prayer time is not going to be that long. But when there's praise and worship, worship music, you can be in here for hours and pray to the Lord. Why? Because there's something about that music that will begin to trigger a chemical reaction in your mind and your life. And all of a sudden, the music goes up, your prayer goes up. Ever done that before? I mean, you're in here praying, all of a sudden the music starts going up and you start going up higher. Music goes up and you go up higher. And all of a sudden music goes down and you go down higher, right?
Yeah.
So you begin to go as it goes. Amen? But all it's doing is it's creating something in your mind that is sending signals to your heart. And all of a sudden the Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth is speaking. And that's why we cannot look people based off of feelings. Because feelings come and go. Do you know they say that every 5 seconds your mind will send chemical reactions to your heart? Meaning your feelings can change like that. That instant, that quick, your feelings can. You can love him, and in 2 minutes you can hate him. There it goes again. Quiet. You can pull down the stars, and then you can pull that hot burning sun at the same time. Right? Why? Because they change quickly. Feelings change quickly. And Jesus is telling us to love the people that hate us, that despise us. And I can almost guarantee you that the minute that you walk out of this place, the devil is going to come in and tell you, let me see if what you heard today, either you're going to put it to work or there's going to be triggering a chemical reaction. And come on, somebody, because that's what the enemy does. Because you might hear something good. You might hear the word, man, pastor, whoo, that was a good word. Praise God, I am changed, delivered. You walk out of this thing and all of a sudden, Guarnitos come on. Right? Come on, somebody. I know. I am preaching to you today. You know, you can be in here hollering and screaming, but once you walk out of this door, when the pastor's not there, when the praise and worship's not there, and all of a sudden something happens, something said, something you saw that was not right, triggers something in your mind, and all of a sudden, whoo. Just like if you were a good angel, you became a dark angel. Am I telling you the truth? Right? I've experienced that. I experienced where they're preaching the word here, that all of a sudden it took, and I'm like, oh man, and all of a sudden, you know, there was a time I preached something here, I walked back, oh, I think it was that one day that it happened to me, but I was preaching here so hard, and I said, man, even whatever the waitresses do, whatever you get your meal wrong, whatever, you know, you still got a love on them and this and that. And then here we go, we went to the restaurant, and all of a sudden we're all sitting down in this table eating, and all of a sudden the waitress comes, and I had on a white shirt, and then the waitress comes with some big red, and she tripped, and guess where it landed? All over my back on the white t-shirt. Good thing I wasn't wearing no VCC, no pastor shirt, no nothing. I didn't do that. All I did is like, and I mean, you know, it was in a Mexican restaurant. It was a Chinese restaurant, and I don't know what she told me because she wasn't speaking in English. But you got like that. But there were some with me that did not react the way I reacted. They knew. They're like. And what happened is what I was bringing here, the enemy was waiting outside. And sometimes he waits outside to see. Let me see if what you're preaching is you're really applying it to your life. Or let me see what you're hearing, you're really going to apply it to your life when nobody's here, when there's no worship, when there's no angels flying around inside the church. Let me tell you something. The enemy will come in and try to mess with you, with mess with your mind. And the thing about it is that how are you going to react? What chemical reactions are going to go through your body when there's no praise, when there's no worship, when there's not a pastor there to tell you, stop that, don't do that, don't say that, stop. What are you going to do? It's getting quiet in here. This is what I told you. When something like that happens, what do you have to do? Just pray. Pastor, that's the last thing I want to do. No, pray. If you get it, pray. Pastor, I don't even want to be near. Pray. Call upon the Lord. Because he said, if you call upon me, he said, I will answer you. Amen?
Amen.
So, listen. The Lord is telling us to do something. He's telling us to love. Love your enemies. Love the people that hate you. Love the people that despise you. Pastor, that's hard. I mean, but you know how much better? Can you imagine what would happen to that person that just cursed you or talked about you if you go over there and do something nice for them? Can you imagine what's going to happen in their mind? You just mess them up. They begin to scratch their head like, what's going on? I just cursed them up. I just threw the finger. I just did this to them. And look at the way they're repaying. They're loving. They bought me lunch. They bought me a soda. They bought me. When you do that, it'll begin to mess with the enemy. Because that's what the enemy does. See, the moment that you react different, the enemy gets all confused. Like, wait a minute. I just did all of this to them, and they're praising God. What's going on? Amen? And if you ever want to silence your enemy or your critics, do totally the opposite of what they're expecting you to do. If they're expecting you to come in and raise all hell, don't do it. Just walk in there nicely and in peace. That's all you got to do. Because the first thing that we want to do as flesh, we want to pay it back in a bad way. Amen? No, not me, Pastor. Let me put you in a situation. Let's see if that's going to be good. We all react like that. We all do. Pastor, you mean that tomorrow, I'm not telling you that from now on you're going to be this, you know, this holy one that's always going to be walking with, you know, wings. No. What I'm telling you is that try to learn to react differently. than the way you used to react. Amen? Is it hard? Of course it is. But can I just tell you something? And this will probably just change the way you view things. Jesus would not tell, or God would not tell you to do something that wasn't already inside of you. He would not tell you to do something that, He would not tell you to do something that was totally out of the norm. He would not come in and expect something from you that He did not put inside of you. He did not expect you to be a Chinese when He made you a Mexican. Right? Now, listen. If God tells you to love the person, it's because He already placed something in you. And what did God place inside of you? He placed Himself in you. And the Bible says that God is what? Say it again. The Bible says that God is love. And if He lives inside of you, guess where love is? And the Bible says that if you do not love, you don't know God. If you don't love, you don't know God sent you. I took an extra 5 minutes, God. Okay. Just for you.